chapter 8, verse 26 to 39. They sailed to the region of the Gerasenes, which is across the lake from Galilee. When Jesus stepped ashore, he was met by a man possessed by a demon from the town. For a long time, this man had not worn clothes nor lived in a house, but he had lived in the tombs. When he saw Jesus, he cried out and fell at his feet, shouting at the top of his voice, "What do you want with me, Jesus, Son of the Most High God? I beg you, don't torture me." For Jesus had commanded the impure spirit to come out of the man. Many times it had seized him, and though he was chained and foot kept under guard, he had broken his chains and had been driven by the demon into solitary places. Jesus asked him, "What is your name?" "Legion," he replied, because many demons had gone into him, and they begged Jesus repeatedly not to order them into the abyss. A large herd of pigs was feeding there along the hillside. The demons begged Jesus to let them go into the pigs, and he had given permission. When the demons came out of the man, they went into the pigs, and the herd rushed down the steep bank into the lake and drowned. When those in the pigs saw what happened, they ran off and reported in the town and countryside, and the people went out to see what happened. When they came to Jesus, they found the man from whom the demon had gone out, sitting at Jesus' feet, dressed and in his right mind. And there they were afraid. Those who had seen it told the people how the demon possessed man had been cured. Then all the people in the region of the Gerasenes asked Jesus to leave them, because they were overcome with fear, so he got into the boat and left. The man from whom the demon had gone out begged to go with him. But Jesus said, "Turn away," saying, "Return home and tell how much God had done for you." So the man went away and told all over the town how much Jesus had done for him.
Thank you, Eduardo. What a great time last night. I don't know if you were able to be here, able to be part of the Harvest Festival, but we had a bunch of people and a bunch of you helping, and it was always a really good thing. We're going to be talking a little bit about an evil world and about where Jesus is today, but we were able to see a lot of things. I got one picture. I know Brandt has a whole bunch more that are going to be a whole lot better, but there was a ton of people here. It was really a great time, and so I appreciate all the things you guys have done and all the work that you did and inviting our neighbors in and dressing up like crazy people. I've got some of those too. But it was a great time for that. So we had lots of people, and you guys did lots of things, and it all went smooth, and it was easy to get it all put away. And so I appreciate all the work that went into all of this. Next Sunday is Mission Sunday. Somehow our cart has grown. I take it the ox has grown too. So I don't know where he is, but be careful where you step. Okay, that's the main thing. All right, so as we talk about evil, and some reason this time of year we tend to think about that maybe a little bit more with Halloween and some of those things, I want you to realize some things about God and some things about where evil comes from. And I'm just going to give you my take on all of this, and so that's the best I know how to do. God is good. See, why do you say that? All the time. It's just an automatic response that's been trained into us. I hope we know what that means, and that we know that is absolutely true, that God is good, and goodness exists because God is. And that's His nature, that's His character, that's who He is, and that's what makes goodness possible. And I'm so glad that God is good and not God is something else, because that allows the world to be good, because He's the one who makes all of this. He's the one who creates all of this, and it's what makes everything be the way it is. My idea, and you don't have to have all these because there's 100 other different theories, God is eternal. God always exists, and so therefore goodness always exists. But the opposite of that also exists. Because you can't have good with no comparison. And so the opposite is always true. No one created evil. It's there because of the goodness of God. It's there because God is this great good person, this great good God. And that's where it really fits. We'll talk about that some more in just a minute. But incredible, it just simply is. But it is so much less powerful than God, because God is the positive force. Evil does nothing except try to destroy. So I have a ghost story to tell you. There are no ghosts in it. But it's what we call a ghost story, I guess, because this story is just really scary. And Eduardo has read it to us already. And as you start looking at the beginning of this, they go across the Sea of Galilee and they come to the land of the Gerasenes. This is not Israel anymore. And he tells us about that. This is away from God's people, away from the place where God is. This is clear over in the country of the Gerasenes. And so things are not the same there anymore. It's not like it was. And so there is a man from the city. Interesting. The man from the city is one of them. They probably knew him before. He wasn't born with demons. I don't know exactly when they came into him, but demon possession back in this time was where Satan could literally come into a person and take control of them. They no longer had their own power of speech. They no longer could walk the places where they wanted to. They were no longer in control of anything that they were physically doing. It absolutely took control of their body. And there was a guy from town that everyone knew that one day just, let's kind of stay away from him. He removed himself from society, or the demon removed him from society. He's completely away from this. He is not close to it anymore. In fact, he is so far, he does not live in a house. He lives out among the tombs. I told you it's a ghost story. Not only that, but it's rather risque because he doesn't wear clothes anymore. Don't want your kids walking home that way. So no house. He lives in the graveyard. He cries at night because this thing tortures him so much. He cuts himself with rocks, it says in Mark. He's bound with shackles. They've tried to chain him up, and he keeps breaking the chain. That's a big guy. It's not so much the guy's big, but what possesses him is big. And that's got to be huge for him to be able to do something like that. He is so strong, nothing is able to hold him. No matter how many people get him and finally put chains on him, he breaks the chains. So there's no chain big enough to hold him. In fact, when Jesus asks, "Who are you? What's your name?" he answers, "My name is Legion." The term for legion, the number for legion is 6,000. I don't know if there's exactly 6,000 demons within one guy, but you got to know the force of evil and the power of this evil in this one guy is horrific. Because he says, you know what, there's so many of us in here, we just named the neighborhood. That's what we do. We just, it take too long to give you all of our individual names. He has lost control of himself. He has lost control of his actions. He doesn't get to do anything that he wants. He's lost control of his speech. He is intent on his own self-destruction, discomfort, torture, pain, everything that you can possibly imagine, just because evil is there and evil is within him. Don't you know that's a terrible thing? And when Jesus sails to that land, he is right there to meet Jesus. Because as evil as this guy is, he comes before Jesus and he is afraid of Jesus. He says, "Why are you here? What are you doing here? Have you come to torment me?" As if you could torment a demon? I mean, what would you do to this guy that hasn't already been done? But it's the demon in him that's saying, "I'm having fun tormenting the guy. Please don't torment me. I'm supposed to have longer." And what does he mean by that? I'm supposed to have longer. Well, there's a time when demons had been released, and then there's a time when the apostles are casting out demons. And fortunately for us, they cast them out. They go back into the pit or the abyss, as is mentioned here. And then they're no longer free. They're no longer loose again. And so I think that's part of what happened at the time of Jesus, so that you can see this huge contrast between what's good and what's evil. You are literally able to see what happens when Satan takes over a person in a physical way. And they had taken over this guy. And what a scary thing. You don't even need a Halloween costume. You are Halloween. That's just terrifying to be able to think that that happens like that. And so he is afraid of Jesus. Why are you here? What are you doing? And he recognizes Jesus. He recognizes the authority of Jesus. He recognizes the power of Jesus. He confesses, Jesus, I understand you're the Son of the Most High God. Why are you doing this? I'm here and I want evil. And he has no power to change any of that. And the man asks, well, can't you just send us into the pigs? Don't you know that's what people always wanted to do, right? Send me into pigs. Pigs rush down the hillside and drown themselves because they can't do that. They can't contain the evil that is within them. I assume at that point then they pass back into the pit or the abyss and they lose the ability to be in this world any longer. And so they didn't gain anything by going into pigs. It's not now we have demon pigs called javelina. No, that's really not the case here in Arizona. But it just brings me to the fact that sometimes people will tell you things that isn't what they want at all, and it's motivated by something completely different. You know, send me into pigs, or, you know, I like my life where it is. No, you don't. You're just familiar with the misery. And so you're so miserable, you know that, you know, I don't want to go around anything better. I feel bad when I go around something better because I'm not there. And I'm so familiar with the place where I am that just let me stay here. And you find this whole story is about people who don't want change. It's just a matter of being able to stay exactly where they are with all the evil that they have. And they say, this is fine. He recognizes the authority and power of Jesus and he says, leave me alone. I like evil. As you look at the next section, the herdsmen saw what happened. They fled and told it in the city and in the country. And people went out to see what had happened. They came to Jesus and they found the man from whom the demons had gone sitting at the feet of Jesus, clothed and in his right mind. And they were afraid. That's an impressive passage to me. And they were afraid. A man who no longer has evil, who is sitting down, who is clothed, and who is being still at the feet of the Son of God. See, what they're afraid of is the Son of God. And those who had seen it told them how the demon-possessed man had been healed, and all the people in the surrounding country of the Gerasenes had asked him to depart from them, for they were seized with great fear. So he got into the boat and he returned. The man from whom the demons had gone, begging that he might be with him. But Jesus sent them away, saying, return to your home and declare how much God has done for you. And he went away, proclaiming throughout the whole city how much Jesus had done for him. Interesting is the herdsmen have watched all of this happen and seen this great healing and this great power over evil. It says they flee. They were fine with the guy being there and just don't eat too many pigs and, you know, I understand evil's over there, but now they run away and they get other people and they come out and they look at what's going on and they see a normal scene and they're scared. They're scared because there's a guy who can make it normal. There's a guy who can throw out evil. There's a guy who has the power over evil to cast it out and to say, you're not going to be in this world anymore. And Jesus is that guy, and you're there, and he's taken control, and he's given the guy back control of his life. And now he's able to do all of these things, and they come out and they see, well, Well, they see a lot of dead pigs, I guess, and the economy's kind of in the tank, and it's not going to be good, and but they find a man with no demons sitting and clothed and in his right mind, and they're scared to death of Jesus. They're not scared of the man. They weren't scared of the man with evil. And we kind of do that today. We're not really afraid of evil because we are used to it. Does it need to change? Does it need to be better? Well, I don't know. Can you? I guess if we can make it better, or would we be like them and say, no, we're kind of used to it. Evil makes us miserable. It just does. But a lot of times today, we choose it. I'm not sure he chose all that. Is of a man who is completely controlled by evil. There's another one with a man with a son who's possessed by evil, and his report is it throws him into the fire and into the water. And so the question becomes, would you rather be burned or drowned? Not to death. He's just going to make you miserable. And we'll do it over and over and over. And dad's got to watch his son until he realizes, I've got to rescue him every single time because the demon is doing this to me. I don't want either one of those. I wouldn't like to be drowned, but I sure don't want to be burned. That's going to hurt a lot, but I'm not sure drowning doesn't hurt a lot. So which one's better? And the man wants to go back with Jesus. He says, well, get me out of here. Get me away from all these people who know just how crazy I am and how bad this world has been for me, and how they've all seen me naked, they've all seen me out in the dunes, and I am Halloween. I am the thing that they're all should be afraid of, but they're not. They're afraid of Jesus. And he wants to go back with Jesus, and Jesus says, no. There's one thing you need to do to make this complete. I want you to go home and declare how much God has done for you. That breaks the chain. Not the ones where they tried to bind evil, but that breaks evil's chain. It breaks any power Satan has over him. Because he's willing to say that. He's willing to confess that. He's willing to share Jesus at this point. Free of all those chains when he faces people and says, yeah, that was me. That was me. Declare how much God has done for you. Are you kidding? That would be an easy story for him, right? It's harder for us. Why is it harder for us? Well, because I didn't sin all that much. Yeah, right. Just go with that. No, I just don't want to tell the story. I just don't want to say all the times I was angry. I don't want to say all the times I wanted to kill somebody but didn't. I don't want to say all the times when those thoughts were so bad. I don't want to say all the times when my attitude was horrible and when I had no grace and no mercy and wished bad things on people. And I don't want to, you get the point, maybe, that there's a lot to confess if we really want to say, my life is different now. Because it might be easier for him. All he's got to do is sit down and be quiet. We've sat and been quiet for a long time, and so we might need to get up and go do something. We might need to get up and speak and let our behavior speak for itself. We show now what God has done for us. That's a horrible story. But it was one that gives me such hope that a guy like that is going to be in heaven. I want to see that guy. Wow, what a change in his life. But where does evil come from? How do we get this? Where do we all begin with this? And so let me share with you a couple of things. I don't have time to do it all, but we'll talk about a couple of things perhaps that may give us an idea about this. If you go back to the book of Job, and you look at Job, who lives very early, we're probably familiar with Abraham just after the flood and the time when Abraham lives. Job's around that time, just just because of other historical things within the book, and that's kind of where they put the story of Job, even though it's found much later in your Bible. If you look at Job chapter 1, Job is a great guy. He loves God. He takes care of his kids. He does everything he can to worship God, and he offers sacrifices just in case my kids might have done something wrong. His kids are that good. Okay? You already know my kids are not that good. So you would know that repentance is needed. He's already just in case. They eat dinners together. They have this tremendous family. And Satan comes. It says in verse 6 of chapter 1, "Now there was a day when the sons of God came to present themselves before the Lord, and Satan also came among them. And the Lord said to Satan, 'From where have you come?' And Satan answered the Lord, and he said, 'From going to and fro on the earth, and from walking up and down on it.' And the Lord said to Satan, 'Have you considered my servant Job, that there is none like him in the earth, a blameless and upright man who fears God and turns away from evil?' Satan answered the Lord and said, 'Does Job fear God for no reason? Have you not put a hedge around him and all his house and all that he has on every side? You have blessed the work of his hands, and possessions have increased in the land. But you stretch out your hand and touch all that he has, and he will curse you to your face.' And the Lord said to Satan, 'Behold, all that he has is in your hand. Only against him do not stretch out your hand.' So Satan couple of things about this I want us to realize as you look at this. Satan was in heaven. Maybe we think that doesn't happen or that's impossible, but there was a time when Satan was in heaven. Not only was Satan in heaven, but Satan was not an angel in heaven. Satan was Satan in heaven. And I know there's a lot of times where people have an idea that Satan was an angel that fell and later became Satan, and I'm not here to debate that theory, all right? If that's what you believe, that's fine. I don't really think that way, because then you've got to go to the side that says, all right, Satan isn't the original source of evil, and so evil existed before Satan was, and so how do I get evil into a world where Satan chose evil when, you can see where I'm going, maybe. Now, angels did sin. Angels were thrown out of heaven. That's absolutely the fact that we have scriptures about that. I'm just not sure that Satan was among them, because Satan is already Satan in heaven, and perhaps it occurred before this, but I think there's a different place where Satan is thrown out of heaven. And so the idea that evil existed before Satan can be really confusing, at least to me. Goodness is tied to God, and it's tied to God as a person. This world is personal. It is not random. It is not choice. It is not evolution. It is personal. Somebody intentionally did it. And I always think Satan is tied to evil. Somebody is doing evil. Somebody is doing bad, and they intentionally and purposely have a choice to choose it, and that is Satan. The opposite side. We are not random choice. We are not random creation. This world is personal. And creation is exactly that. It was intended. But I do want you to understand what happened. I know you can go on forever and ever debating that. I'm the only one with a microphone. So we'll table that one for later. We do see Satan able to function on the earth and be in heaven in Job. He does appear to be limited. He's been able to go wherever he wants on earth and in heaven, but he seems to be limited. He still has access, but he cannot touch Job. And his accusation to God is, you've protected Job. You've been there. You've blessed all the works of his hand. You've put a hedge around him. And yes, God has done that. And God does do that. God does protect us from evil. He says, Satan, I'm not letting you touch my best guy. And God says, you know, have you looked at Job, how great he is with all the blessings I give him and how he chooses good every time? And Satan says, that's only because you won't let me get to him. And God says, all right, I will let you go this far. You can affect his possessions. Satan says, okay. And he does the maximum. I want you to realize that Satan always does the maximum. He doesn't take one child. He takes all of his children, all of his cattle, all of his possession, all of his camels, everything that he has. And he does it all in one day so that right one after another, he gets the worst news of his whole life in an attempt to destroy him and to discourage him. And Job still responds and said, you know, I came with nothing. I'm going out with nothing. Praise be to God. Satan failed. And he comes back to God in chapter 2 and he says, well, of course that happened because you didn't let me touch him. And God says, okay, you can touch him, just don't kill him. Satan is limited by God. You to know that today. He does not have any more power than what God allows him to have. And sure enough, he does the worst with Job. He goes in and he makes him sick. Boils all over. And he sits on an ash heap and he has the worst possible physical life. At least when we get sick, we go to a hospital. You know, one of those places of torture where they poke you with sharp instruments. But I think it must be better than the place where he was on the garbage dump where you're scraping yourself with the broken pottery. And it's got to be better than that. I'm not sure, but I think it might be better than that. The people with the needles seem awfully happy. But I don't think they're intentionally that way. But he does have an influence over where he is. And Satan always does the maximum. Takes everything that you have. But God places limits on it. I want to share with you today what I think the real power is in all of this. It's found in Revelation chapter 12. Let me give you the introduction to this. Revelation 12 gives you a picture. And that picture is of a woman. The woman is pregnant, about to have a baby. The woman is God's people, and there's going to be a child that's born. There is also a great red dragon, and that great red dragon has 7 heads and 10 horns and a tail that sweeps away a third of the stars. That's angels that fell. I think Satan's the one that did that. And the woman comes to term, and she gives birth to a male child who will rule the earth. It's a symbol of Jesus. And the child is caught up to God and to his throne, and he is protected there. And the woman flees to the wilderness, a place prepared by God, and she is there for 1260 days. The passage is about the people of God. That's the woman. About Jesus being born. About the limitation and protection of God. Jesus comes through the people of God, through Abraham and his descendants and descendants. And then we get to verse 7, the war. Now a war arose in heaven, Michael and his angels fighting against the dragon, and the dragon and his angels fought back. And he was defeated, and there was no longer any place for them in heaven. And the great dragon was thrown down, the ancient serpent, who is called the devil and Satan, the deceiver of the whole world. He was thrown down to the earth, and his angels were thrown down with him. And I heard the loud voice in heaven saying, now the salvation and the power of the kingdom of God and the authority of his Christ have come. For the accuser of our brothers has been thrown down, accuses them day and night before our God. And they have conquered him by the blood of the Lamb and by the word of their testimony. And they love not their own lives even to death. Therefore rejoice, O heavens, and you who dwell in them. But woe to you, O earth and sea, for the devil has come down to you in great So Michael and his angels are fighting this war in heaven, and the war is against Satan. It's not another angel who's there who has sinned. It is Satan and his forces, his angels. Satan fights back, but he is defeated. And this is the point at which Satan is thrown out of heaven. We find him there earlier, but at the cross of Jesus, that is the real power over evil. Satan is thrown out by Jesus at his cross, because look at what happens in all of this. And he identifies him. It's the devil, it's Satan, it's the dragon, it's the serpent. They're all the same. He's the same person. I want you to know that. And so as you look at all of this happens because of Jesus, and Satan is thrown out of heaven, because look at the response after this. He says, now salvation and power have come. That's because of the cross. Salvation is only after the cross. The kingdom of God and the authority of his Christ are there because of the cross. They conquer by the blood of the Lamb, that's Jesus on the cross, and by the word of their testimony, that's the disciples after the cross, and now rejoice in heaven that he has been thrown out of heaven. See, the other ideas kind of leave it that, well, you know, there's kind of this war, and then Satan's thrown out, but, you know, now we're in a, no, the real power is the cross of Jesus. That's what I wanted you to see today. That's what we're able to have today, is this real power is being the cross of Jesus. That is the power against evil. That is the thing that changed everything for all time. That is what influenced you as the way in which you read the scripture. The devil is thrown down to earth. He has only a short time, and he is angry, and he is limited, because Jesus and his cross have limited what he's able to do. It's not like Job. You see, without that, you've got the Gerasene demoniac. You've got a Satan who's able to come in and physically afflict you and tear up your life and do all kinds of horrible things to you. But with the cross of Jesus, you have a whole different world. Because he is unable to touch you now when you believe in Jesus. He has already defeated Satan. He's already defeated death. He's already done all these things. And now we live within the power of Christ. There are no stories like the Gerasene demoniac after the cross of Jesus. There are no stories like Job after the cross of Jesus. The real sadness in all of this is we choose to make ourselves like Job. We choose to make ourselves like the Gerasene demoniac when we run after evil. We say, oh, it looks like fun. Of course he makes it look like fun. Let's all play in the tunes. It should be great, right? By the way, you're never going home. And we live in a world that has lots of evil in it. I want to tell you, it could be so much worse, because this is a world that is limited by Satan. He does not have power over us. And you think about what would happen if Satan could take your child and put a demon inside of your child, and you have to live with that and protect him from being thrown into the fireplace every single day. Let's be thankful we don't have to worry about that. And he cannot do that unless you give him permission. What an incredible thing this cross of Jesus is, and how he's been able to do this. Because this is the first time in all of history that is the dividing point. And Satan was bound at the cross. You look at Revelation 20 and a few other passages, and it talks about that timing, and I don't have time to go into all of that, but he is bound now. He has set limits, and we are reigning with Christ now. We are able to be part of that. He conquered evil, and he conquered the grave, and you can choose to have this great blessing in Christ of power over Satan. He is not able to touch you. You have that protection like Job had. still coerce, but he cannot go beyond what God has limited. We have no idea how evil this world could become. I wonder sometimes if zombie apocalypse wasn't created to give us a concept. But you know what? Apparently you can blow them apart with a big gun. You cannot blow apart evil with a big gun. It is never going away. We live with it. And God says, you know what? I'm going to bring you to a new place where it's not allowed anymore. It's not going to be part of where you are. Because Jesus has come. Romans chapter 5 and verse 6. For while we were still weak, at the right time Christ died for the ungodly. For one will scarcely die for a righteous person, though perhaps for a good person one would dare even to die. But God shows his love for us, and that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Therefore, since we have now been justified by his blood, much more shall we be saved by him from the wrath of God. For if while we were enemies, we were reconciled to God by the death of his Son, much more now that we are reconciled, we shall be saved by his life. More than that, we also rejoice in God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have now received the reconciliation. While we were weak, while we were ungodly, while we were caught in evil, Jesus died for us and made a separation point so that it can no longer have control over you. All you have to do is choose Jesus. All you have to do is decide that, you know what? God has taken away. He has the power over evil, and he has left a path for me where I don't have to be afflicted by it. Now, it's still going to be there because those people live next door, right? You know the demon kids next door, right? I mean, they're still there, and they're going to come knocking on your door for Halloween demanding candy. But we don't have to have that in our family, in our life, with our kids, with our friends, with our people that we know, and people in this church, because Jesus and his cross have taken all of that away. What a tremendous thing it is. God shows his love that while we were sinners, we're saved from the wrath of God, saved from evil, saved. His Son has reconciled us. 1 Peter 2:21 says, he himself bore our sins in his body on that tree that we might die to sin and live to righteousness. By his sins you have been healed. By his wounds you have been healed. Satan has been thrown out of our life. Satan no longer has that. When we make a covenant with Jesus, he no longer has control. When we repent of our sins and we're baptized into Christ, Satan no longer has control. As soon as you do that, until you do that, you're at risk. As soon as you do that, you're buried with Christ. His death comes. It takes over. It relieves all of the pressure of evil in your life and says, don't do it again. Don't go back to it. Yeah, we still struggle with it. Yeah, we're still going to fight with it because it was just 3 days ago that we were doing some pretty horrible things. But he says, I will give you all the power of the cross. And Satan is limited. Jesus can have all of that. Satan can still tempt. But you can say no. Before, I'm not sure you were allowed to say no. Jesus has this power. Because he took all that Satan could do to him. That's what he did. He was an innocent man who was beaten, scorned, mocked, crucified, and evil did everything evil could do to him. And then Jesus got up and said, and that was for them. I'm innocent. I'm not guilty. That death was their death. And we accept it and we realize Jesus won. He conquered Satan. And we are baptized and buried with Christ into his death. We're raised to walk in new life. Satan has been bound in this world force us to do evil. He can't control our speech. He can't control our actions. He can't throw us into fire or water. He cannot destroy us. He cannot accuse us, or else Jesus answers, "Oh, shut up. I already did that." He is the accuser all the time. He says, "Those are my people." My question is, do you want to be one of those? Sin takes you where you don't want to go. It keeps you longer than you want to stay. And it costs you more than you want to pay. It's very deceptive. But today, Jesus has you are able to have all of this blessing in Christ. Today I want you to come if you don't have this yet. Let us make that possible for you. If you've already received that,